We continue with our study on the book of 1 Samuel, and as of today, we are in chapter 20 and 21. So last week, Pastor Joe took up chapters 18 and 19, and we are great believers in the power of revision, and I think it is good for all students to revise. It increases your memory, and since we are students of the word, we will revise briefly what he said last week. So, as I went through the message last week, since I was not here in person, I went through the PowerPoints. I saw that the focus was on the word covenant, and the word covenant was described as berith in Hebrew, which means to cut. And the word covenant would mean you getting into a relationship, a kinship, someone becoming family to you. And if that relationship were to break, then it would be as good as the shedding of blood, actually cutting up someone or something. So the word in Hebrew is berith, and the word in Greek, you see, the Greeks always like to make distinctions. You know, Hebrew will have one word, Greeks will come up with two, so that they can define it more precisely. So in Greek, there's one word which goes like suntheke, which is a joint obligation. So both the people in the covenant are responsible for keeping the covenant running. So the other word is diatheke, in which one person or one party acts in the favor of the other, and it is this party or person who acts as the benefactor and literally holds the relationship on his or her shoulders. Immediately I could think of two parallels, two examples. The first example which I could very obviously think of was God and his relationship with us. Just like God told Abraham, blessing, I will bless you, and I will bless you, and I will make you a blessing. So Abraham had nothing to do except just to receive the blessing, right? In the same way, when we believe in Jesus, we just have to receive the salvation, and we don't need to act to receive our salvation except just standing there, you know. If it is too complicated, let me give you a more near ground level example. I was thinking of suntheke as joint obligation. Me and my wife, both of us are responsible for running our marriage. Diatheke, I was thinking of me and my daughter, who is very small. She has no responsibility, so to say, as of now, but obviously we hope that gradually relationship between me and my daughter and my wife and my daughter will progress from diatheke to suntheke, right? So this was a little recap of last week. And while I was thinking about today's message, the theme that I thought I would like to focus on would be the emotion of jealousy. I think we are exposed to it every now and then. And since I'm looking at the theme, though I would like to go through 20 and 21 chapters too, it may make some sense to refer back to some verses in chapter 18 and 19 itself. Now, someone has said that a jealous spouse does better research than the FBI, isn't it? And someone said, I'm in love with my bed, we are perfect for each other, but my alarm clock doesn't want us together, she's jealous. So what is jealousy? You know, jealousy is one of the strong emotions known to us, and it's actually a mix of a lot of negative thoughts and emotions of insecurity, fear, comparison, anxiety, and loss specially in correlation to another human being. Not in correlation to what you can ideally be, not in correlation to what God wants you to be, but in correlation to another human being. And very close to jealousy would be envy, where we are very conscious of someone who has a superior quality and we lack that superior quality. We are conscious of this person who has more achievement, more possession, and we either desire that we should reach that stage or they should lose it. That is worse, isn't it? And from the month of 5 years old, you begin to experience jealousy. So when we have a little baby who comes home with his or her parents, we have to be very conscious, because we see that our daughter feels little jealous if that baby sits rather close to us. So we have to ensure that she does not feel emotionally left out. Many years back, when mobile phones were introduced in Bombay, I don't know how many of you have seen those original mobile phones, you know, those brick-sized phones. And those times, calling rates were in the lines of 30 rupees per minute, 50 rupees per minute, 60 rupees per minute. And we would give a missed call. Even incoming calls were charged. And I remember in a local train journey, a lady sitting in first class, obviously, and started her phone call at Borivali and concluded it at Dadar. And many people were so upset with her. It was not jealousy. It was jealousy in the form of irritation. Isn't it? So, jealousy has many colors, many shades. We are too sophisticated to admit that we are jealous, but the truth is, it is easy for us to be jealous. So it is said that utility is when you have one phone, luxury when you have two, opulence when you have three, and the circle has come, it's become full circle now, and paradise is when you have none. So I actually feel that, how can I come to a stage where I don't need to carry a phone and someone else can obviously take my calls? So when we look at jealousy, let us look at chapter 18, few verses that I would like you to look at, and we'll quickly come to 20 and 21. I promise you will not miss that. You have in your notes, okay, you have in your notes these phrases: the trigger, the bullet, and the victim. So I thought, how can we unpack intense emotion like jealousy? And when I looked at that, I saw 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 7. Now, that is the original social media where Saul hears, he meets these women coming out, and they say, and the women sang to one another as they celebrated, Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s. So this was the trigger. And Saul faced this trigger, and you and me face various kinds of triggers. But what I want to clarify is that a trigger on a gun is useless if there is no bullet in the gun, right? So where is the bullet? The bullet is Saul's interpretation of what these women said. Now Saul says, verses 8 and 9, now this is Saul's conversation with himself. Saul says, and Saul was very angry, and this saying displeased him. He said, they have ascribed to David 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed thousands, and what more can he have but the kingdom? And Saul eyed David from that day on. So the point that I'm trying to make here is that around you, around me, there will be many triggers for us to feel jealous. However, please remember, the trigger is useless till there is a bullet in the gun, and the bullet in the gun is the quality of my thinking. Now, jealousy thinking or envy thinking thinks exactly like this, that they have ascribed to David 10,000s and to me just thousands, and what more can he have but the kingdom? So there is a trigger, there is a bullet, and the bullet is fired, and whom does it hit? Who is the victim? Verse 10, the next day a harmful spirit from God rushed upon Saul, and he raved within his house while David was playing the lyre, as he did by day. Saul had his spear in his hand, and Saul hurled the spear, for he thought, I will pin David to the wall, but David evaded him twice. So when I am jealous, when I am envious, and I fire that gun, it's me who is the victim, isn't it? So Saul suffers for being jealous, and more on jealousy and envy later. Let us stick to the syllabus, and let me read for you 1 Samuel chapter 20 before we go further. So then David fled from Naioth in Ramah and came and said before Jonathan, what have I done? What is my guilt and what is my sin before your father that he seeks my life? And he said to him, far from it, you shall not die. Behold, my father does nothing either great or small without disclosing it to me. And why should my father hide this from me? It is not so. So Jonathan says that it is not likely that Saul wants to kill him. Again, the background here is that chapter 18, Jonathan tries to act peacemaker and convince his father that it will not be a right thing for him to attempt to kill David. And for that time, Saul indeed said that as surely as the Lord lives, I will not kill David. But David vowed again, saying, verse 3 onwards, your father knows well that I have found favor in your eyes, and he thinks, do not let Jonathan know this, lest he be grieved. But truly, as the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, there is but a step between me and death. Then Jonathan said to David, whatever you say, I will do for you. David said to Jonathan, behold, tomorrow is the new moon, and I should not fail to sit at table with the king. But let me go, that I may hide myself in the field till the third day at evening. If your father misses me at all, then say, David earnestly asked leave of me to run to Bethlehem, his city, for there is a yearly sacrifice there for all the clan. If he says, good, it will be well with your servant. But if he is angry, then know that harm is determined by him. Therefore, deal kindly with your servant, for you have brought your servant into a covenant of the Lord with you. But if there is guilt in me, kill me yourself, for why should you bring me to your father? And Jonathan said, far be it from you, if I knew that it was determined by my father that harm should come to you, would I not tell you? Then David said to Jonathan, who will tell me if your father answers you roughly? What if your father does not allow you to come out and meet me? And Jonathan said to David, come, let us go out into the field. So they both went out into the field, and Jonathan said to David, the Lord, the God of Israel, be witness. When I have sounded out my father about this time tomorrow or the third day, behold, if he is well disposed towards David, shall I not then send and disclose it to you? But should it please my father to do you harm, the Lord do so to Jonathan and more also if I do not disclose it to you and send you away that you may go in safety. May the Lord be with you as he has been with my father. If I am still alive, show me the steadfast love of the Lord that I may not die. And do not cut off your steadfast love from my house forever when the Lord cuts off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth. And Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, may the Lord take vengeance on David's enemies. And Jonathan made David swear again by his love for him, for he loved him as his own soul. Then Jonathan said to him, tomorrow is the new moon, and you will be missed, because your seat will be empty. On the third day, go down quickly to the place where you hid yourself when the matter was in hand, and remain beside the stone heap. And I will shoot 3 arrows to the side of it, as though I shot at a mark. And behold, I will send a boy, saying, go, find the arrows. If I say to the boy, look, the arrows are on this side of you, take them, then you are to come. For as the Lord lives, it is safe for you, and there is no danger. But if I say to the youth, look, the arrows are beyond you, then go, for the Lord has sent you away. And as for the matter of which you and I have spoken, behold, the Lord is between you and me forever. So, right up till this point, chapter 20, verses 1 to 23, both David and Jonathan make a plan to understand Saul's motives. Now, we see that Saul has been going through his own troubles, and his troubles are self-inflicted, obviously, and in his jealousy, he has hurled a spear at David. David has evaded him twice. So, while I was thinking about all that was happening to Saul, and Saul being afflicted, and Saul effectively being a very disturbed person in a murderous rage most of the time, I began to think of the importance of what we think. And the Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, that we have to occupy our mind with what is true, what is noble, what is right, what is pure, what is lovely, and what is admirable. Someone said, and I think we know that the word of God is God himself. When we read his word, we strengthen our spirit. And when we walk in his word, we experience intimacy with God. Now, if I were to decide to actively walk in opposition with God, actively think those thoughts which God does not want me to think, what would happen? I think Saul shows to us that when we begin to think in those terms, not only do we lose peace, but there is something which begins to happen at a spiritual level. We know that demons exist and demons interfere in the lives of people. They make things hard for people and for people who want to follow God. So while that traffic is there, it is also possible that if I choose to think negative, if I choose to think ungodly, I may inspire demonic forces to hang around me. And that's what happens with Saul. Do we remember that in the New Testament, Satan is pictured as the Lord of the flies? And where would you find a bunch of flies? You'd find a bunch of flies next to a garbage dump. So, when my thoughts begin to resemble a spiritual garbage dump, flies may not be far away, isn't it? So, next please. So, when you look at what is happening to Saul, you begin to hear of, you hear the counter current of the Bible, which has many things to say about envy and jealousies. The Bible says, Proverbs chapter 14, verse 30, it says, "A tranquil heart gives life to the flesh, but envy is the rottenness of bones." So, very orthopedically directed verse, but very true. When you are thinking jealous, you are setting yourself up for a lot of stress. And 1 Corinthians chapter 13 verse says, "Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy." So, when Jesus was asked to summarize the commandments of God, he summed it up these two ways. Love God with all your heart, all your strength, all your mind, all your understanding, and love your neighbor as yourself. So how can I love my neighbor if I am envious? And it's not only in the New Testament, even in the Old Testament, when you look at the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20 verse 17, it says, "You shall not covet your neighbor's house, your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, female servant, ox, donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's." Now, what is interesting about this commandment? The interesting thing is that the commandment to not steal and the commandment to not commit adultery has already preceded this commandment. So while those commandments ask you to prevent the actions of stealing and the actions of adultery, this commandment seeks to prevent even the thinking that would precede adultery or stealing. So, by the way, jealousy, envy, covetousness, all fruits hanging on the same branch. Not even the same tree, the same branch. So, God is basically behind, basically against this kind of unjust acquisition, because it goes 180 degree opposite to the command to love your neighbor. And Luke 21 verse 15 reinforces this when you see it says, "Take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." James chapter 4 verses 2-4 says, "You covet and you cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions." So we find this guy, our friend, poor Saul, stuck in this feeling of jealousy and envy and unable to see the commandments which were given much before he landed on earth. Now, in contrast to what Saul ends up doing, we see Jonathan, who is actually the unsung hero of this part of scripture. And if I were to read from verse 24 onwards, we'll see what Jonathan did. So, back to the text. So David hid himself in the field, and when the new moon came, the king sat down to eat food. The king sat on his seat as at other times on the seat by the wall. Jonathan sat opposite, and Abner sat by Saul's side, but David's place was empty. Yet Saul did not say anything that day, for he thought, something has happened to him. He is not clean. Surely he is not clean. But on the second day, the day after the new moon, David's place was empty. And Saul said to Jonathan his son, why has not the son of Jesse come to the meal either yesterday or today? Jonathan answered Saul, David earnestly asked leave of me to go to Bethlehem. He said, let me go, for our clan holds a sacrifice in the city, and my brother has commanded me to be there. So now, if I have found favor in your eyes, let me get away and see my brothers. For this reason, he has not come to the king's table. Now what happens to Saul? Then Saul's anger was kindled against Jonathan, and he said to him, you son of a perverse, rebellious woman, do I not know that you have chosen the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of your mother's nakedness? For as long as the son of Jesse lives on the earth, neither you nor your kingdom shall be established. So now Saul was effectively intent on cursing David, and he is now actually cursing his own son, and he is putting his jealous thinking into his mind and explaining to him the implications of what happens if he lets David go. He says, neither you nor your kingdom will be established. Therefore, send and bring him to me, for he shall surely die. Then Jonathan answered Saul his father, why should he be put to death? What has he done? And you know, people who are angry throw things. So Saul hurled his spear at him to strike him. What is the difference? This time Saul is hurling a spear at his own son. Imagine if the spear had met its target. What would have happened? So Saul hurled his spear at him to strike him. So Jonathan knew that his father was determined to put David to death. And Jonathan rose from the table in fierce anger and ate no food the second day of the month, for he was grieved for David because his father had disgraced him. In the morning, Jonathan went out into the field to the appointment with David, and with him a little boy. And he said to this boy, run and find the arrows that I shoot. As the boy ran, he shot an arrow behind him, beyond him. And when the boy came to the place of the arrow that Jonathan had shot, Jonathan called after the boy and said, is not the arrow beyond you? And Jonathan called after the boy, hurry, be quick, do not stay. So Jonathan's boy gathered up the arrows and came to his master. But the boy knew nothing, only Jonathan and David knew the matter. And Jonathan gave his weapons to his boy and said to him, go and carry them to the city. And as soon as the boy had gone, so now Jonathan and David are alone, and what follows is their conversation. David rose from behind the stone heap and fell on his face to the ground and bowed three times. And they kissed one another and wept with one another, David weeping the most. The Bible makes it a point to mention David weeping the most. Then Jonathan said to David, go in peace, because we have sworn both of us in the name of the Lord, saying, the Lord shall be between me and you, and between my offspring and your offspring forever. And he rose and departed, and Jonathan went into the city. So this is the last time that David and Jonathan meet each other in such a peaceful manner. There are many instances in Scripture where you would see the effects of jealousy play out. We have seen in the book of Genesis Cain murdering Abel. We have seen Aaron and Miriam criticizing Moses. We have seen Joseph's brothers throwing him in a pit. And in the New Testament, we have seen the chief priests jealous of Jesus. And after the resurrection of Jesus, they were jealous of the apostles' popularity. Now, what is the similarity? The similarity here is that all these people who were jealous, all these people who were afflicted by envy, did not have a good outcome. They had to repent. They had to turn. And those who did not were destroyed. So we look at Jonathan. Last week, we saw how David suffered. And I want to, this time, this week, think of what went through Jonathan's mind. Now, it is a small thing for any of us to give up what is spare, you know, to give up maybe even what is sacrificial. But when Jonathan gave to David his bow, his arrow, his garment, and when he ensures that David leaves safely, what is Jonathan giving up? Jonathan is actually giving up the kingship. He's actually giving up his future. He would have been the next king. But he gives up that right because with his spiritual discernment, he can see that God has chosen David and no more his father. So Jonathan was put in that spot, and it was a difficult spot to be in. And the lessons that we can draw from his life is that the only antidotes that we know to jealousy would, number one, be thanksgiving, being always thankful to God for what we have. You know, Colossians chapter 3 verses 15 to 16 says, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. So all of us who believe are called in to be a part of one body, right? And to be thankful. Then the Bible talks about contentment. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 10. The summary of it being, there is great gain in godliness with contentment. Godliness with contentment. We may have heard of a popular story, and the story goes like this, that there is a fisherman, he's relaxing on the beach, and he has caught a few fish, and here's this businessman who owns fishing boats. He walks past that guy and he says, why are you wasting your time? Why don't you go back fishing and catch some more fish? And this man says, I have caught enough fish for the day and a few to sell. So I'm happy. So why should I go? So the man says, you should go because if you catch more fish, maybe you can buy one more boat. And then you can buy one more boat. And then one day you can have very big boats. And then this man says, after that what? So he says, then after that, You can sit on the beach and relax. And the man says, I'm already doing that. So, godliness with contentment is great gain, but we don't have a full stop here. The Bible says it gives us a paradox. The paradox is, I am content with what I have right now, but I also strive to be what God wants me to be. Not what society wants me to be, not what my neighbor looks like, but what God wants me to be like. So contentment, yes, but contentment is not an absolute virtue. We have to keep in mind the value of godly ambition. Remember, God told Cain, Genesis chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, he says, why are you angry and why has your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? So I can tackle my jealousy at various levels. One, I can renew my mind by focusing on the things which the Bible asks me to focus on. I can develop a habit of thanksgiving. I can develop the habit of contentment and yet work with godly ambition. So, chapter 20 shows us Jonathan, the unsung hero, very much like Jesus, who came on earth, left his kingship so that we could acquire his kingship, so that we could be seated with God in the heavenly places. So Jonathan resembles Christ in being able to give up his throne so that you could sit on the throne with God. Let's look at chapter 21. So now David is out of Israel. I mean, he's out of the royal circle, and David is now officially fugitive. But this is fugitive part one. Fugitive part two happens after David, some chapters down the line, after his long nap, he happens to do something, and then fugitive part two begins. But I think that's not part of today's message. So we'll focus on what happens to David now. So then David came to Nob to Ahimelech the priest, and Ahimelech came to meet David, trembling, and said to him, why are you alone and no one with you? If you were to suddenly see the chief minister walking on the road alone, we would definitely feel that something is out of order. So David said to Ahimelech the priest, the king has charged me with a matter and said to me, let no one know anything of the matter about which I send you and with which I have charged you. I have made an appointment with the young men for such and such a place. Now then, what do you have on hand? Give me 5 loaves of bread or whatever is here. And the priest answered David, I have no common bread on hand, but there is holy bread, if the young men have kept themselves from women. And David answered the priest, truly, women have been kept from us as always when I go on an expedition. The vessels of the young men are holy even when it is an ordinary journey. How much more today will their vessels be holy? So the priest gave him the holy bread, for there was no bread there, but the bread of the presence, which is removed from before the Lord, to be replaced by hot bread on the day it is taken away. When I read this first time, and if you were to read this without reference to the New Testament, you may wonder what is happening here. But Jesus in the New Testament brings this instance up to demonstrate a lesson in Mark chapter 2 verses 23 to 38. You would see Jesus telling his disciples and confronting the Pharisees and Sadducees and reinterpreting this passage to them. What did Jesus mean at that time? See, the Pharisees and Sadducees had become more ceremonial than spiritual. And Jesus demonstrated to them that in a position like David's, when David's life was under threat, it was okay for him to take this bread instead of the bread which was made on a daily basis. Now, unfortunately, besides this, there seems to be a servant of Saul called Doeg the Edomite, the chief of Saul's herdsmen, who was there that day. Verse 8, then David said to Ahimelech, have you not here a spear or a sword at hand? For I have bought neither my sword nor my weapons with me, because the king's business required haste. And the priest said, the sword of Goliath the Philistine, whom you struck down in the valley of Elah, behold, it is here, wrapped in a cloth behind the ephod. If you will take that, take it, for there is none but that here. And David said, there is none like that, give it to me. So, summary of the matter, David is a man on the run. He is hungry, he needs food, he got bread, he does not have a weapon. A soldier needs weapons, and David got a sword. And I think he may have been encouraged to get the same sword which would have reminded him of the great victory which he had against Goliath some time before this happened. So clearly, David is not acting in an ideal way. He is saving his skin and he is on the run. And now David exits the territory of Israel. And verse 10 onwards, what do we see? And David rose and fled that day from Saul and went to Achish the king of Gath. And the servants of Achish said to him, is not this David the king of the land? Now this is an interpretation that they have attached. Is not this David the king of the land? Because till now, obviously, Saul is the king of the land, right? Did they not sing to one another? Oh God, that same compliment again. That dangerous compliment. Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s. This compliment does not seem to be leaving David alone, isn't it? Wherever he is going, this compliment is following him. Sometimes I feel these kind of compliments are more dangerous than criticisms. It reminds me of Joseph's dreams. Of course, the thing, little thing with Joseph was, he himself went about telling people, this is my dream. One day I will be even better than you. One day I'll stand on such a height and you'll be looking up at me like that. So that was his problem. But in David's life, wherever he goes, this two-liner permanently tags him, Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s. What does David do? And David took these words to heart and he was much afraid of Achish the king of Gath. David might be thinking, if Saul wants to kill me because of this, what about this king who I don't even know? What will he do? So, David does what you see in the movies. So he changed his behavior before them and pretended to be insane in their hands and made marks on the door of the gate and let his spittle run down his beard. I think just like dogs scratch doors when they are uncomfortable, and spitting on your beard is offensive Eastern thing. I mean, you are out of your mind if you are spitting, and spitting on your beard even worse. Then Achish said to his servants, now Achish also has a sense of humor, you know. He tells the servants, behold, you see, the man is mad. Why then have you brought him to me? What does he say? Do I lack madmen, all of you around me? Do I lack madmen that you have brought this fellow to behave as a madman in my presence? Shall this fellow come into my house? So somehow, David saves his life, which was endangered by that great compliment. Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s. David would have been so regretful that those women were dancing. And this is the poem that they came up with. As I told you, the power of social media even in those times. So what is the conclusion? I think David acted insane, but Saul actually went insane. Insane with anger and insane with his jealousy. Psalm 34 verse 19 sums all of this perfectly for me. It says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. So David goes through many fluctuations, many trials, many temptations, and he sees God deliver him out of all these afflictions. However, unfortunately for Saul, this is just the start of a downturn. And the message that we take home for us is that we are responsible for what we think. And the New Testament has given us all the things which we should think upon. And when we think upon God's word, we protect ourselves from the strong, negative, destructive feelings of jealousy, anger, irritation. Basically, the whole collection of what we can call a lack of love. Because what is primary is, as Jesus said, loving God with all your heart and loving your neighbor as yourself. The problem with jealousy is that I will not be able to love you if I'm jealous of your BMW. Isn't it? So what I'm trying to say here is God delivers us from all afflictions and he expects us that we would walk with him. David demonstrates till now that he is walking with God, and Jonathan, with his tremendous sacrificial friendship, again points us to the central figure in Bible history and in our life, and that man is Jesus, the ultimate friend, the ultimate friend who gave up a lot, not because it was his responsibility to give up things on my behalf, which brings me to the diathike part of the covenant, but because he loves you and me, he gave up everything he had so that you and me could be called friends of God. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for men like Jonathan. We thank you for examples like him. Lord, as we go to our places of work where we need to compete, Lord, and as we live in our societies and in our family, extended family and relationships, where sometimes people may make unhealthy comparisons, help us, Lord Jesus, that we will compare ourselves with Jesus and with what we can be in Jesus instead of the person whom we are supposed to love in your will. Thank you, Father, for the supply of your Holy Spirit. And thank you, Lord, for your word, which teaches us all these things. In Jesus' name we pray.